Hi, I'm James Piercy, Communications Officer at the John Innes Centre here in Norwich.
And my name's Beth Nichols, and I'm a plant scientist at the John Innes Centre.
Really excited to have Dippy the Dinosaur visiting the city, and he's down in the Cathedral right now. It's got everybody thinking about the age of things, because Dippy the Dinosaur is 150 million years ago. We thought it'd be interesting to think about the history of plants too.
And what better place to do that than here in the Earlham Cemetery, just a stone's throw from the John Innes Centre, where we're surrounded by plants of all different kinds.
Tiny plants such as grasses and mosses, to huge plants like this beech tree behind us.
This tree is huge, Beth. It must be really old. So let's have a go and see if we can work out just how old it is. I've got a tape measure. So
Brilliant.
If you take that end and go round the tree, we'll see how big it is. As trees grow a little bit in each season, they get bigger, don't they? So it'll be further and further round the tree. So we need to measure it and see what it is. So how many inches is that?
That is 189 inches.
Okay. So what we need to do is find out from that circumference what the diameter of the tree is. So we need to do some maths. So I'm just going to divide that figure by pi, 3.14. And then I'm going to times it by the growth rate for the tree. And for a beech like this, in this sort of environment, it's about four times. So that means that this tree is about 240 years old. Can you believe that?
That's incredible.
That means that it was here before the cemetery. I think that's quite cool.
But the plants we're going to be looking at today are going to be much, much older than this. We're going to be looking at their ancestors, which will have evolved millions of years ago.
So not just how old the individual plants are then, but when the first examples came about.
Exactly. So not this beech tree, but when the first beech tree appeared on Earth.
So come with us on a walk back through time to find out about the history and evolution of plants and the things that are around at the time of Dippy the Dinosaur. So if we're going to think about the evolution of plants, we're going to be thinking about some really long periods of time. So perhaps a good way to help us understand that is to turn time into distance. So we can measure time and we can say that 1 millimeter is going to be the same as 1 year. Okay? So I'm really old, I'm nearly 50. So that means I'll be 5 centimeters on our tape measure. And that giant beech tree we saw, that was 240 years old. So that's going to be 24 centimetres. And Dippy the Dinosaur is in Norwich Cathedral at the moment. And the cathedral is just under 1,000 years old. So that's 1 metre on our measure of time. Now, what about something that's even older than that? Well, over near Thetford is Grimes Graves. And they're a big pit where our ancestors mined flint. And they're about 5,000 years old. So that would be 5 metres, won't it, on our tape measure. Quite a long way now.
Okay, so let's have a think about our own ancestors. Homo sapiens, first human species, and reckon they arrived on the Earth about 300,000 years ago. So that's going to be 300 metres on our scale. I'm going to have to pace that out.
If we want to find something that's really, really ancient, we could think about the very earliest human-like species that came around, Australopithecus, and that's about 3 kilometres away, about 3 million years ago. And about 3 kilometres from here is the John Innes Centre, where we're from. So the most recent kind of plants evolved were the flowering plants, or angiosperms, and we've got some beautiful examples right here. What are these, Beth?
These are called Rose of Sharon.
Okay, Rose of Sharon. And we can see these incredible yellow flowers on there. What are those flowers actually for?
So flowers are a really important part of the reproductive cycle in angiosperms. They attract pollinators, and the pollinators take the pollen from one flower and transfer it to another flower so that then they can fertilise each other.
Okay, so they can reproduce, and presumably it also allows plants to reproduce with different plants to create more diversity. There's some really interesting work happening at the John Innes Centre at the moment, exploring the ways that flowers attract pollinators, not just by their colour, but by their smell as well.
So My name is Kelsey Byers. I'm a group leader here at the John Innes Center. So I work on floral trait evolution. So I try to understand how different traits, like the color of flowers, like the ones behind us, or the scent of flowers, or their shape, affect pollinator behavior. So bees and butterflies and so on, and how that affects the evolution of flowering plants and their diversity on the planet. So in terms of floral traits, I mostly focus on floral scents. We've actually known for thousands of years as a species that flowers have smell and that insects can smell them. So Aristotle actually wrote about this in one of his books. But for centuries, we forgot about the fact that plants smell. And a large part of that is because smell is really hard to study. So it's easy for strongly scented flowers like roses. You can bury your nose in them and you can say, yeah, this totally smells. But many flowers are scented very weakly, and so only insects can smell them. So I actually work on flowers that are more like that. So we know in some species, for example, that scent is important for evolutionary differences between species, and also in understanding how new species come to be, a process that's called speciation. So I've shown, for example, in one group of plants called monkey flowers that are native to the United States, that scent is actually really important in keeping species apart.
So some fascinating work there about the smells, the pheromones that flowers can produce to attract pollinators, as well as their colour. So Beth, if these flowers appeared about 140 million years ago, was Dippy the Dinosaur romping around in the daisies?
No, Dippy the Dinosaur would never have seen a flower. Most of what we see are flowers, but unfortunately, no, his landscape would have looked completely different.
So how long after Dippy did the flowers come?
About 10 million years.
Wow, that's a huge thing, isn't it? So on our map, that means that I'll be with the flowers in Grimsby. Dippy, you can be Dippy, you're looking Immingham. Lovely yep. place. And we'll never actually meet each other. It's kind of crazy to think about that. Something else that will blow your mind is that on the way to Grimsby, we've passed T-Rex, who is in Peterborough. So actually, there's less time between us and T-Rex than there is between T-Rex and Dippy the Dinosaur.
That's incredible.
It's crazy, isn't it? We think about dinosaurs, they just sort of all live in this little lump, don't they? But they're actually spread over tens of millions of years. So if the angiosperms, the flowering plants, weren't around at the same time as Dippy the Dinosaur, what kinds of things were there?
So things like gymnosperms would have been around, which are plants that have their seeds in a cone, like this one behind us.
Cool. And there's loads of different kinds of cones, isn't there? I've got a few here. Look, that enormous one.
That's huge.
And the smaller one. And we're used to seeing things like this on pine trees and so on, aren't we?
Yes, and this sort of plant would have evolved about 300 million years ago. So they've had quite a lot of time to evolve.
300 million years. So that's about Durham on our distance map. So a huge long distance. There are lots of conifers like this one in the cemetery here. Loads of different types, cedars and cypresses and all sorts of things like that. And there's some more unusual gymnosperms as well though, aren't there?
There are some great examples of gymnosperms in this cemetery, like a giant sequoia, which is among the oldest and biggest trees in existence on the planet. And my personal favourite, the ginkgo, which I'm going to take you to go and see now. Of a ginkgo tree, and these first evolved in the Jurassic period, which is about the same sort of time as Dippy the Dinosaur. So Dippy may well have seen some of these trees' ancestors. Ginkgo trees are always really easy to spot because they have these incredibly unique leaves with these two lobes on them. Ginkgos are amazing trees because they're actually dioecious, meaning that each tree has a different sex, either male or female. And the only way that you can tell them apart is when they start fruiting, when they produce their cones. The females have the cones on them, and these cones smell really terrible, so it's really important to be able to tell the two apart so that you plant the right one. But unfortunately for a lot of people, they buy what they think is a male ginkgo tree, but the branches on the trees can actually change sex at any time. So while you might think you're lucky enough to have a male ginkgo tree like this growing in your garden, you may end up with a branch or two with those female fruits on them. I wonder what Dippy would have thought of the smell. Now let's rejoin James and travel even further back in time to see what evolved before Dippy that he may have encountered. found up there, James?
Well, I've travelled 360 million years into the past, nearly all the way to Scotland, to have a look at a fern.
Beautiful.
Yeah. So before the angiosperms, plants evolved flowers. And even before the gymnosperms with those seeds, we find plants like this that don't have either. Have a look.
Thank you. Ferns like this are examples of sporophytes, so named because they've got spores on the back of their leaves, which is their reproductive system.
So the wind just blows those spores and then new ferns grow.
Yeah, pretty much.
And I guess this is going to be the main foodstuff for a huge herbivore like Dippy the Dinosaur. So those spores need to spread a lot, because that's going to eat a lot of salad, that creature.
Back in the 1920s, the then John Innes Horticultural Institution really led the way in studying ferns. And a scientist called Irma Anderson Cotto really pioneered the way in understanding genetics and inheritance by looking at these amazing plants.
Over here I found some really great examples of primitive plants. So we've got liverworts and we've got mosses.
They're really small, aren't they?
They are, they're tiny, and it's because they don't have a vascular system, which means that they don't have an efficient way of transporting water around them, much like we've got veins and arteries.
Okay, yeah, so my blood carries the oxygen, the nutrients that I need around my body, and the plants have a similar thing then, do they?
They do, yeah. Their vascular system looks a little bit different, but plants as small as these won't have those. So if they were to be much bigger, then it wouldn't be very efficient for getting the nutrients around the different parts of the plant.
Okay, so I can understand that these must have been the earliest kinds of plants to evolve then. How long ago do you think? Where are we on our map now?
So this is 500 million years ago, which is a really long time, and that takes us back to Glasgow in Scotland now.
Wow. Well, we've reached Glasgow on our journey back in time. We've travelled 500 million years and we've seen a huge range of different kinds of plants and thought about when they evolved. So when you go and see Dippy the Dinosaur in Norwich Cathedral, have a think not just about that amazing creature, but all the incredible plants too. 500 million years is a long time.